Howdy. I'm here to touch a couple things up. On my engine cowling here where I would like a little more consistency in the fill. This line here is just a little cleaned out. Hit it again. Want the lines to be consistent, that's all. Alright, and that's all that's required there. Pleased with how easy going that oil wash was. So I do believe I'm going to go oil wash on the rest. Here we have the Winton oil color, Windsor and Newton. Don't have any black mixed up, so I'm gonna have to mix up a little black. And man, is this stuff ganky. I mean, I know it's oil color, but man, it's greasy. Hey, Mike. How you doing, bud? Yeah, the detail on that engine cowling really looks good. I hit another couple little spots just now to even up the lines. Had a couple little spots where I could squeeze just a little more fill in there. And I'll give that another wipe. But that worked so well. I did that with oil color. And that worked so well. I'm going to go ahead and do oil color for the rest of the wash. And it was really not a greasy mess like it was, or like it has been other times. that up with mineral spirit. A glaze technique. Yeah. Pretty much just put it on there, let it get in the cracks, and then wipe it off the surface without wiping it out of the cracks. Rivets, you know, any little recessed detail. And then I'm hoping, I haven't had good luck in the past with this part of it, but I'm hoping the wipe up, instead of wiping it all 100% clean and only leaving it in the lines, I'd like for, you know, a little bit of the wash to sort of dirty the surface a little bit. A little bit thick. Now this should work like an enamel wash too, where you get it thin enough that all you do is come over here and touch it to a panel line and it flows through the line. But these panel lines are so fine what you're talking about, what's the glaze made out of? I want this a little bit thinner. I'm still torn about these lines on the bottom of this, on the belly. I still have concerns that they might be a little dark. I all the time talk about subtlety with the lines like that, and those lines are anything but subtle compared to the top. So I'm going to wash the top, see what it looks like, and leave the option open for spraying a little bit more color on the bottom. There's a guy on YouTube whose videos I watch, and he takes a wide brush and just covers the entire wing. Just washes the whole thing out completely. I'm gonna try to avoid doing that because that makes the cleanup really quite a mess. I totally lost a piece last night, man. A little itty bitty tiny sliver of a piece. I ended up vacuuming and having to sift through the dust cup to try and find it. God, it was a nightmare. I had it in my tweezers and it shot out of my tweezers and bounced off my paper here. It was lost for hours. I thought it was going to be gone forever. But like 9:30 at night last night, I was in here vacuuming my room. Vacuum a little square foot area and then dump the dust bucket and go through it. Some of these lines are wicked fine. I hope they take the wash. Been a while since I've done the oil. Past couple projects I used enamel. And the enamel dries almost, well, the enamel wash dries almost right away. Put it on, blow on it a little bit, give it 10 minutes. And then you have to go in with a thinner of some sort. I use mineral spirits instead of enamel thinner. And you go in and wipe it off. But when I did that engine cowling that you saw, I didn't have to use any thinner with that. I just used a makeup sponge. And after it sat all night drying, all night long, I went in with a makeup sponge and just gave it a gentle rub. And it acted perfectly, man. It acted like a champ. I was pleased. Then after I wipe it off, I'm gonna have to give it like 3 days to sit here and dry as much as possible before I put a clear coat on it to seal it in there. Does anything special happen on Twitch when you get 50 followers? I'm almost to 50. I've seen some dudes mention making affiliate. I think you need a couple hundred for that. Yeah, that's an idea. I could also grab it with a hair dryer on the cool setting a little bit. My profile, when you load my main page, I think it only says model maker. Arts and crafts. Yeah, I should do that. Makers and crafting. Not all these features are recessed. I'm having a hard time seeing which ones are recessed and which ones are surface. I want to make sure I get all the rivets. Most of those guys that were in here the other night when you dropped in, most of those guys are from a Discord server that I got invited to. I've been posting my channel there, but recently I haven't done many posts about going online. Several of my streams have been much smaller, a little shorter. think I got a couple lines down the fuselage here. I really tried not to sand up along here, just for these lines. Now there is a lot more recessed detail on the belly, but I'm gonna get these last couple lines here, and that's all I'm gonna do for this. Let this dry overnight, wipe it down in the morning. Body painting. Not gonna wash around the canopy. Let's see. And I'm a little concerned. This looks a little rough. I hope that's not an issue with the clear coat not reaching there. Appearance there. If there's an issue with there not being sufficient clear coat, the oil paint will stain the enamel. I don't want that. So I'm going to brush just a little bit of clear in that location. Just to be sure. Keep a whole jar of the clear coat for dipping clear parts in. You dip these clear plastic parts in that acrylic clear that I use, and man, it makes them look fantastic. They look like glass. Should do it. I do believe. Also under art. Yeah, I gotta add more categories. I'll do that after I end this stream. And I can still use this tomorrow, but I gotta cover it. Can't cover it with that. I need that. that way aside to dry overnight like. And these awful pieces, I said I was gonna strip them, and I did. Put them in a little shot glass of alcohol. It didn't strip them 100% because I didn't go at them real aggressively. But I wasn't happy with some of the seams on these. All the seams on the plane I'm really happy with. So I didn't want to come up short on these. My little collection of sandpaper. Tell you what though, man, my hits on YouTube have gone way up here lately. I don't know why. I mean, I usually don't pay too much attention to the analytics. When I first upload a video, I watch it for the first week or so to see if it's getting any hits or anything. But I looked in on the analytics section, and there's a graph. A bar graph by hourly hits, and I can look back and see in like this hour I got 10 hits on different videos, and this hour I got 15 hits. But forever, and I mean since 2006, that was only ever showing, you know, if I got 10 hits, if I got into double digits in 1 hour, 20 hits or something like that, that would be really incredible. I just never had that much activity. And then recently, that's been getting up to 50 and 60 hits in an hour. Consistently over not every hour, but over, you know, periods of days. I'm getting that many hits. It's unusual. And a lot of the stuff is on old videos too, I think, that are hitting. I mean, I'm still getting 4 and 5 hits on my Twitch streams that I export there. But I've got a video of a band doing it was a Memorial Day party outside. And the band did Victim of Changes from Priest. And they only had one guitarist. He covered all the parts. They had a girl from another local band was singing with the lead singer, so they traded parts on and off. And man, that thing is steady getting hits all the time. Really amazing. I'm not gonna bother repriming these. Stripping them did take off most of the primer too. But it'll be fine. For cameras, I have an old Microsoft LifeCam. It was a standard camera by Microsoft back in the day. If you look at the overhead camera, it's that one. I actually have it lashed on to my GoPro gooseneck thing with a little piece of twine. And then my other camera is, if I can get the light out of the way, is that one. It's a Spedal, it's called. It's a 1080p camera. It's all manual focus. You know, I have to go into the software and adjust the aperture and light balance and stuff like that. So it doesn't, you know, it has a good focal range, but it doesn't autofocus. So if I wanted to show something up close to it, it would generally be out of focus. So I have it focused for you know, my desktop here. But it's a good camera. It's only $40, 1080p. And like I said, it's got decent focal range. It's got a wheel, pretty wide angle, 110 degree wide angle. And this old Microsoft LifeCam, it's only 720p. So I was so pleased with that 1080p camera that my wife needed a camera for school, for taking exams and stuff. She has to do them on camera. Oh, and they're picky, man. The camera has to see her desktop, and her keyboard, and they want to make sure that she doesn't have any aids or anything there assisting her during exams and stuff. But I just bought her one of those, the same 1080p camera. For $40, man, 1080p, and you know, it's a good looking camera. I thought about picking up a third camera. I like the idea of having an overhead on the desk, and you know, then a camera for close up. But I was thinking maybe I could use a camera on my ugly mug. But then I might have to shave or get a haircut. Hey, Papa Dookie. Yeah, I was threatening to strip them down and redo them, and I did just that. Hello, baby. Oh, where'd I leave that? Oh. Yeah, I even stripped down the one from my previous build. So I've got three of them to work with here. I figured, you know, why not? I'm definitely a pick your battles kind of guy. I decided to opt out of spraying more color coat on the belly of my plane to try and fade those panel lines anymore. So since I'm not going to bother to do that, I figured I'll bother to do this. Yeah, the way the software is set up, the streaming software that I use, I can swap between camera views just by clicking. I have these, these different views set up that I can make use of during the stream. Gotta go to my magnifier. Make sure I got these lines cleaned out. I don't know how determined I am, though, to get a camera for my face. I barely like the sound of my own voice. Last thing I need is my own face up there. Got a voice for radio and a face for print. Yeah, that's the way I feel, Papa Doogie. Couple of my guitar videos that I have on my YouTube, I have my face. But I felt better about the ones where I just focused in on the guitar, didn't put my face up there. Yeah, somebody told me that I make stupid faces when I play guitar. I said, no, I don't. That's just my face. Now, this one was good across most of this area. A little bit right here. And I was sort of thinking this, whoops, bumped the cam. I was sort of thinking this is the one I was gonna leave mounted up, just because it looked cool with the little fins and stuff. And it was actually good. This seam here probably wouldn't have been that visible. But the top here, let's see if I can get it to show. I left quite a line there. Just not being very observant as I was working. This one here, this is the one that that got me. I couldn't live with this. I stuck it on the plane. Every time I flipped the plane over and looked at it, that seam poked me right in the eye. Yeah, the alcohol doesn't hurt the plastic at all. You can see I didn't concentrate on stripping it, you know, like 100%. You see there's like remnants of the paint still on there. I took the bulk of the paint off, mainly because respraying it, I didn't want it to look thick and ganky. But normally when I strip pieces with alcohol, it does a real good job. I use a little toothbrush. I have a little shot glass. I go in the bathroom and do it. I have a little shot glass in the bathroom, and I put a little alcohol in the shot glass and submerge the piece for a little bit if I can. It doesn't have to soak overnight or anything, but you know, just like 5-10 minutes, and then I give it a rub down with the toothbrush and a little scrub while it's under the running water. And yeah, the alcohol, the acrylic paint, the alcohol will take it right away. And that won't do anything at all to the plastic. My very first model when I got back into modeling was a P-51 Mustang. And I didn't know that I was supposed to have a difficult time brush painting with Tamiya paints, but I painted the whole model with a brush using Tamiya flat aluminum, and it went without a hitch. It went great. But then I had a can of I'm looking for another piece of sandpaper here. I had a can of clear on the shelf in my workshop, and I went ahead and tried to use that to clear coat it, and it was like a Krylon or something, and it totally didn't react well with the paint. So I determined I needed to strip it and repaint it, and I used lacquer thinner, not realizing, you know. And that took the paint off, you better believe it. But if I hadn't, I didn't know that I needed to be that specially careful just bathing that plane in lacquer thinner. But luckily, I did it just so that it didn't mar the plastic at all. Later on, I found out, geez, how did I get away with that? I'm lucky I didn't destroy that plane. I mean, it was just luck. Closet drinking in the bathroom. Shot glass and alcohol. That's me. But I hear, you know, a lot of guys, they ask those questions all the time in the Facebook groups. How can I strip my plane? And even if it's just a little bit of work with the toothbrush, I would say alcohol every time. Some guys suggest using oven cleaner. And I can't help but think, gosh, so why oven cleaner? I mean, it'll do the trick, yeah. But is there anything more toxic? I wouldn't want to be in, I don't like being in the same state as somebody spraying oven cleaner, yet alone working with it up close, trying to scrub a model. I mean, I just remember when I was a kid and I worked at Roy Rogers, we used to clean the ovens. We just used regular oven cleaner, and that stuff would, you know, it would irritate your eyes, your nose, your throat. I don't know how it is on the plastic, but man, it's hard on the human. Yeah, I got real lucky on that Mustang. And then after all that, it really turned out pretty well. It was the Revell's Big Beautiful Doll. And for my first kit, getting back into it, the kit itself was really nothing. The build was nothing. But man, those decals, getting those decals to conform to the nose, that checker pattern for the nose. Oh, that was quite an experience for a reborn model maker. I think I built that kit, that Revell Mustang kit, as a kid. That's kind of why I was drawn to it when I first got back into modeling. And I don't know how I managed to paint that whole thing with a brush and Tamiya paints. If I tried to do that now, it would be awful. I barely knew anything about retarder or anything like that. Yeah, never tried bleach. I hear some guys do that and Windex, but with Windex, you might as well just use alcohol. Yeah, man. Enamel paints at one time, that was all that was really available for model kits. Little tiny jars of enamel. And I thought I was something special with a can of Krylon out in the driveway. Righty. And then this one has no lines. I don't really need this one. I slept like crap last night. I woke up this morning with that wah 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 on my head. Felt like I'd been up all night long. And I slept, I know I slept, but just the quality of my sleep was awful. Hoping for a better night tonight. Now, I was saying I'm probably not going to bother to reprime these. These probably aren't that important to reprime. Only one's going to go on the plane, the other two will sit on the shelf and look pretty with the extra leftover ordnance. Hey Paint Monkey, how you doing this evening? Thanks for dropping in. Jeez, it's 9:15 already. So I probably won't get the spray in these until tomorrow morning. Let's see about etching some lines here. Oh man, that's a bummer. Stuff of nightmares, man. My experience with the dentist has been nothing but nightmares. And speaking of which, I gotta get back to the dentist myself here soon for some routine stuff. Yeah, true that. They put that thing on your nose and tell you, okay, breathe through your nose for more effect and breathe through your mouth for less effect. I'm there like you know. I'd been knocking my teeth out since I was a little lad. When I was still in the crib, my mother came to check on me when I had teeth. I was still in the crib. My mom came to check on me, and apparently I'd racked my mouth. I didn't cry or anything, but when she came to get me, my teeth were knocked out. Apparently I racked my mouth on the railing of the crib. And then I guess I was like 6 or 7. We were on a family trip on our way up to Maine. We stopped somewhere in Massachusetts so my mom could go to an antique shop. And there was a school play yard across the way. So my brother and sisters and I went over there to play on the playground. And I missed on the monkey bars and smacked my mouth on the monkey bars, knocked my teeth out. And then in 8th grade, I crashed on my bike, did a face plant and broke my teeth off. So then by the time I was 20 or something, I ended up having to get emergency root canal surgery. And my dentist was out of town, and he referred me to somebody. And this guy had a smoking hot dental assistant, and he bitched at her the entire time. I mean, I was scared he was so nasty to her. And then halfway through the procedure, I was gurgling, gagging a little bit, and he stopped and looked at me and says, you don't taste anything, do you? And I nodded, yeah. And he and the assistant both jumped down my throat with the sucker thing and the washer thing, and he had let bleach get into the back of my throat. And I had actually swallowed a certain amount of bleach. So for days after that, I had terrible gastral problems. Passing a bleachy gas and terrible upset stomach. It was a nightmare of a time. My dentist ended up complaining to the dental board about that guy, because he referred me, you know, one of his patients, to him, and he basically subjected me to a nightmare. So my dentist had his license suspended for, I think, like 3 months or something like that. He wasn't allowed to practice. My dentist was vicious to him when he found out the experience I had. So, needless to say, I don't enjoy going to the dentist. Because I have terrible memories. Terrible, deep-seated, horrific memories. One more little line. After I get this line done, before I close my stream out, I'll bring the plane back over. Before anybody got here, I hit it with a oil paint wash for the lines. Just on the top, I haven't done the bottom yet. I'm still hemming and hawing about the bottom. There's an opportunity that I might spray a little more color to fade those lines. I don't know. I just know if I don't, I'll put pictures up somewhere and some knob will be like, oh, look at your panel lines. Looks like a cartoon. But we'll see. I want to see how the wash on the top does. I might be able to tolerate having the lines a little more pronounced on the bottom. It could actually be a natural thing, you know? The top lines are more faded because of bleaching from the sun. Maybe. I don't know. I'm making excuses. Ha 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 ha. I'll buy that excuse, Papa Dookie. I'll buy that excuse. Well, I talk a lot of smack about how the lines should be subtle, color variation and all that. So when I come up short on delivering that, it's just making me think all about it. It wouldn't take much. I mean, I've already clear-coded it, but all I'd have to do is, you know, mix up some I'd have to remask my flaps and landing gear bays. And it wouldn't take much. Part of the reason I don't want to do it is because a lot of my panel lines, I've accidentally taken them too far. And I just feel like if I go back in and try to make that perfect, I'm going to go too far and the lines will be nearly invisible. Alright, so these suckers here are ready for paint. Tomorrow I'll repaint the pre-shading and color coat these, and if there's still a visible seam after that, I will live with it. I think I've decided that I'm going to go with these are old decals from my A6 M2, but I think I've decided I'm going to go with this blue stripe, the V103, and that'll also give me the blue stripes for the tail. Put this on the fuselage. Here's the plane. Went ahead and painted the lines, whether it's raised or recessed. At this point, it was hard to see the difference. I know the two main lines down here are recessed, and they have rivets, so I wanted to be sure to get them. I shouldn't worry about that. And then this blue stripe will go right there, sweeping back this way. I thought about masking for my and painting my own single blue stripe around the fuselage. But you know, as long as I have this decal, I think that'll work just fine. I can use those numbers. And this kit didn't come with anything, you know, special for the rest of the markings, just tail numbers, the meatballs, and the leading wing edges. So I can actually leave most of this decal sheet intact. I'm gonna steal the meatballs, the red circles, from my Academy kit. No, it's a Hasegawa. It's a Hasegawa kit, so that these will have no border. This kit only has two without the border, but I want top and bottom of the wings to have the red circle without any border, the black or the white. And then I have plenty of black and white border ones to use with the Hasegawa kit. And then I'll use these stripes, which were from an A6 M2. This is an A6 M5, but it's a later Zero painted in earlier colors, if you can follow that. Which may have been done. There may have been ones out there, because this the first A6 M5 I think flew in maybe August of 1943, and they didn't change over the colors from this style to the dark green with the gray underside until late in 1943. So there may have been A6 M5s painted in this scheme, but I mostly wanted to paint it in this color scheme because I already have a white one, I already have a dark green one, and when I do the Hasegawa kit, I'll have another dark green one. So I wanted to push one out in this color scheme because that's such a cool color. I really like that color. And that's, you know, historically accurate to what the A6 M2, you know, was it Michael Bay? Michael Bay's Pearl Harbor movie with Ben Affleck. He had dark green zeros flying all over the place, and that I just don't know if any of those would have been dark green zeros in late 1941. They should have been either this green or amber gray. But what can you do? So there we go. So that's me for tonight, just an hour, 15-minute stream so that I could work on those drop tanks and get this line wash on there. I'll give it a wipe down tomorrow morning, let it dry overnight, give it a wipe down tomorrow morning, and see how it looks, and then make a decision about the belly. If those lines on the belly are too dark or not. They might blend okay once I get, once I get black in the recessed lines, and they might not appear too dark. They're pronounced is what they are. So we shall see. There were no zeros that were white. The ones that appeared white were the amber gray, and they may have been sun bleached. But the white zero is kind of a myth. The difference between a warbird and a bird of war. A warbird has come to mean a vintage military plane that's been restored and is owned by the public or public foundations that fly them. And for some reason, many warbird zeros are white. But historically, almost no zeros were white. Let me see if I can find something real quick. I mean, I'm not a big stickler on that kind of stuff, but since this is my fourth zero, or my third zero out of four that I'm going to do, I get wrapped up in it each time, you know, and I read about them, and I watch documentaries, and, you know, all that stuff. I just become enthralled by the zeros. Hold on a second, let me think. Where would it be? Here it is. Here's one that looks like it would be white. And then there it is again. It looks like it would be white. But that's actually what would be amber gray. I thought I had another sheet. Somewhere out here I have another picture that looks just like this one, but it has a white stripe here. And when you see the white stripe on this, that's when you realize, oh gee, that plane's not white. Well, here it is, sort of. There's a white stripe, with this being white and this being the amber gray. But somewhere around here, I have another Zero that has a white stripe on this type of finish, and you can really see the difference that the plane itself is not actually white. And then in most World War II pictures, they're either colorized or just black and white. And when they're colorized, they've missed adding the green hues, the green-gray hues to the to that appropriate green. Yeah, well, that's why I painted my last Zero, the A6M2. I painted it, pure white, because of the warbirds. I was really going for that warbird type of look. What I always thought of as a kid, before I knew the distinctions between the different colors, I would have thought of them as white. I don't remember what was on Baba Black Sheep, but thinking back to that, I just remember as a kid Zeros being white, and I knew I had actually ordered this color for that last Zero. But even so, I still went ahead and painted it white because I wanted to. And I actually on Reddit caught a lot of heat from people because they threw the "but actually at me Zeros were never white," and I'm like, I know that this one's white because I wanted to. So that's almost the reason why I did another Zero again right away, is because I had ordered this paint and it's a cool color, and I really wanted to use it. So after I finished the white Zero, I jumped right back into another Zero, specifically for this color, so that I could use this color and come up with a quasi-historically accurate representation of the Zeke. But one other thing that got me is I follow a lot of Asian builders on Twitter. And just before I was getting ready to paint my A6M2, a Japanese guy that I follow posted his Zero, and his was white, and it looked fantastic. I really liked it. And I thought, I know it's not like going to be museum accurate or historically accurate, but if that Japanese fella can paint his Zero white, why then so can I. So I did, and I'm happy with it. I think it looks sharp, looks great on my shelf. I like showing it off. The panel line pre-shading really came out nice on that one. And so now I'll have all the color variations, whether it's a warbird or a bird of war. I'll have all the color variations in my showcase just for the heck of it. So yeah, that's exactly my sentiment, Papa Dookie. And that's the way I quipped back to that guy on Reddit. It's my plane. I painted it how I wanted to. Damn it. So that's the way I feel about all things. If I want to paint it pink and purple, I'll have a pink and purple Zero. You better believe it. So, all right, well, that's going to be me for tonight. I'm going to call it quits. That was a quick 1 hour stream just so I could clean these up, sand them down, put re-etched panel lines, get the wash on the top side of the Zero. I also touched this up a little bit. I added a couple little swipes of some more oil wash where it might have gotten a little thin. And but that looks really sharp. It's all coming together. And that's going to be me for tonight. I appreciate everybody dropping in. And should I raid somebody? I need to take a look and see who's online here real quick. Come on now. People raid me, so I will return the favor and raid somebody else. Cross Wise deck. People raid me, so I will return the favor and raid somebody. Well, I don't see anybody online. Well, I followed this guy on Twitter, Big Boss Wastek. He's probably just painting some miniatures or something. But I'll drag some people in there for him. And I'll catch all you guys tomorrow. Have a good night.